Now let's move on to another factor, that is temperature. You all know that this factor temperature also has a direct influence on the rate of transpiration. Now what is going to happen? We can consider this factor in two ways. First, you all know that as the temperature is going to rise, what is going to happen? There will be more evaporation of water from the surface of leaves, and if there is more evaporation of water from the surface of the leaves, more will be the rate of transpiration. Why? Because water is evaporating at a faster rate. Okay, so higher the temperature is going to lead to more or increased rate of transpiration. The second way out to understand the influence of temperature is in terms of relative humidity. Okay, so what is relative humidity actually? Relative humidity is the amount of water vapor present in air, amount of moisture present in air as compared to air which can hold the maximum amount of water vapor or moisture. For example, if I say, let's take an example, if I say that the air has 20% of moisture, so to become saturated, what it needs to have? It needs to have 80% of more moisture so that it now becomes 100% what? Saturated. So this is what is relative humidity. So relative humidity is actually the amount of water vapor that is available in the air to the amount of water vapor for saturation of air into 100. It is described in terms of percentage. So if I talk about this formula of humidity, we have the available vapor density. Okay, it is available vapor density is to saturated vapor density. Okay, it is to saturated vapor density into 100. Okay, for example, if we take example, if we have vapor density, available vapor density as 10 gram per centimeter cube, so next if we have the saturated vapor density as 17.3, this is for just an example, and if we multiply this by 100, we will be getting the percentage equivalent to 57 something. I am just writing approximate value, I am not doing the exact calculation, but this is how we say that the relative humidity of air is 57%. Okay, so what happens when we talk about the relative humidity of air? Higher the temperature, what is going to happen? Lesser will be relative humidity. Okay, higher the temperature, lesser will be relative humidity. Higher the temperature, what is going to happen? Lesser will be relative humidity, and this is going to lead to an increase of the rate of transpiration. Alright, so remember how we can explain the effect of temperature on the rate of transpiration. We can explain this effect in two ways. If the temperature is higher, this is going to lead to what? This is going to lead to evaporation, more evaporation. And if there is more evaporation, this is going to lead to increase in the rate of transpiration. And if we talk about temperature in terms of relative humidity, what is going to happen? If the temperature is higher, the relative humidity is going to be lower and the rate of transpiration is going to be higher. So from here we can also make out that relative humidity is inversely proportional to the rate of transpiration. More relative humidity means lower the rate of transpiration, less humidity means higher the rate of transpiration. So it is inversely proportional to. Now next, if we move on to humidity, I have already told you what is humidity. It is amount of moisture present in the air. When you talk about relative humidity, it is available vapor density, means available vapor density upon saturated vapor density. So you can also say that relative humidity can be defined as the amount of vapor that is there in the air and the amount of vapor that is required to saturate that air. Means if you want to achieve air which is fully saturated with vapor, That is relative humidity. Means we have a formula to calculate it, that is available vapor density over saturated vapor density into 100. So we calculate RH, that is relative humidity, in terms of what? In terms of percentage. Alright. So remember, but this has an indirect relationship. It has inverse relationship. How? More the relative humidity, lesser is going to be the rate of transpiration. Less relative humidity, more is going to be the rate of transpiration. Next, we move on to wind. Now, what happens if the wind velocity is appropriate? Remember, I am using the word appropriate. So, there is the availability of water because it is being transpired in the vicinity of the leaves. So, by this wind velocity, which should be appropriate, this is going to be taken to the atmosphere. So, wind velocity has a positive influence on the rate of transpiration. But the appropriate one, if the wind velocity is too much, what is going to happen? The rate of evaporation is going to be more, but the transpiration rate is going to decrease. So, we need appropriate wind velocity so that this boundary layer, what is this boundary layer? As the water is going to be transpired in the form of vapors, they're going to collect at the vicinity of these leaves, okay, from where this transpiration is taking place. This forms this boundary layer. This boundary layer can be made thinner due to what? Due to wind velocity, appropriate wind velocity. So this wind velocity has a positive influence on the rate of transpiration, but it should be appropriate, medium wind velocity. It should not be too lower, it should not be too high. So an appropriate wind velocity is going to affect the rate of transpiration in a positive way. Next, we move on to atmospheric pressure. It also has inverse relationship with rate of transpiration. More atmospheric pressure, lesser is going to be the rate of transpiration. Less atmospheric pressure, more is going to be the rate of transpiration. So where do we find low atmospheric pressure? Usually at high altitudes, when we go up the sea level, what happens? The atmospheric pressure is reduced. When this atmospheric pressure is going to be reduced, this is going to lead to increase in the rate of transpiration. But something very, very interesting over here, I have to tell you that nature has planned everything in such a way that it is actually absolutely amazing. So here I want to tell you, when we talk about higher altitudes, I have told you the atmospheric pressure is less over there, and if this pressure is less, the rate of transpiration is going to be more. But this is compensated as we go higher. At higher altitudes, the temperature is also lower. So due to low temperature, what is going to happen? The rate of transpiration is going to be decreased, because I told you temperature has a direct influence. For example, if I make a graph with temperature, it has a direct relationship. Higher the temperature, higher the rate of transpiration. Lower the temperature, lower the rate of transpiration. So in this case also, if we talk about atmospheric pressure, if this atmospheric pressure is reduced, transpiration rate is higher. But this generally happens where? It generally happens at higher altitudes. That is why nature is so amazing. You can see at higher altitude, temperature is already quite less. So this is going to reduce the rate of transpiration, which is actually beneficial for the plants which actually grow at higher altitudes. Next, we move on to soil water. Now, from where the plants absorb water? Obviously, they absorb water from soil. So, the presence of soil water is an important factor which decides the rate of transpiration. If the presence of soil water is sufficiently good enough that the transpiration rate can be maintained to a certain level, then this obviously has a positive influence. If the soil water presence is not to a sufficient amount, this is going to affect the rate of transpiration obviously. So the presence of soil water also has an important role to play to determine the rate of transpiration. So now let us recall again, what are the external factors, the factors which influence the rate of transpiration? We have discussed light. Light is one of the most important factors which determines the rate of transpiration. If the intensity of light is more, this is going to lead to more the rate of photosynthesis, means the stomata needs to be open now. Why? Because during photosynthesis, gases exchange has to take place. And if the gases exchange has to take place, stomata needs to be open. Why? Because during photosynthesis, oxygen is given out and CO2 is taken in. And this gases exchange takes place through these pores, that is stomata only. So what happens? if the intensity of light is more, the rate of transpiration is also going to be higher. Then we talked about temperature. We have discussed temperature's effect in two ways. When we know that if the temperature is higher, this is going to lead to more evaporation. So obviously, the rate of transpiration is also going to be higher. And if we talk about comparing it with relative humidity, remember, higher the temperature, lesser is the relative humidity, more will be the rate of transpiration. Why? Because temperature and transpiration have direct influence. They are directly proportional, I mean to say, but relative humidity and transpiration are inversely proportional to each other. So you can write it as simply in a term, if I say that temperature is directly proportional to rate of transpiration, and we can also write that temperature is inversely proportional to what? Relative humidity. So we can conclude over here as that rate of transpiration is also inversely proportional to relative humidity. Rate of transpiration is inversely proportional to relative humidity. So this is the first statement, this is the second one, and by combining these two, we have got this. So remember that temperature has direct influence on the rate of transpiration, and humidity is inversely proportional to the rate of transpiration. And what is relative humidity? I have told you. For example, you all know that we have moisture in the air, and when the air becomes fully saturated, now air is 100% saturated. So relative humidity is available vapor density, available vapors in the air is to saturated vapor density, when the air is fully saturated with vapors, into 100. So it is calculated in terms of what? In terms of percentage. Okay. Next, we move on to wind. As I told you, when water transpires, it collects near the vicinity of these leaves and forms a boundary layer. Okay, so when this boundary layer is there, if the wind of appropriate medium velocity is blowing, what is going to happen? This is going to take water vapor along with it. So this is going to increase the rate of transpiration. But when this wind velocity is very slow or very fast, this is going to affect adversely the rate of transpiration. It is going to actually lead to what? Closure of stomata. So remember that temperature and wind, if the temperature is too high or too low, or the wind is at a higher speed or at a very slow speed, they are going to affect transpiration adversely. They will actually lead to the closure of stomata. So transpiration can also be decreased if we talk in this sense. So we need appropriate temperature actually and appropriate wind velocity for effective transpiration in case of plants. Next, we talk about atmospheric pressure. This atmospheric pressure is what? It is the pressure which is there in case of what? When you talk about high altitudes, you know, high altitudes have low atmospheric pressure. So the rate of transpiration is going to be higher, because this is also indirectly, this is related. Why? Because it is inversely proportional to rate of transpiration. So at higher altitudes, the atmospheric pressure is low. This is going to lead to higher rate of transpiration, but I told you that nature has amazingly done what with this case. You all know that when the atmospheric pressure is low, it is always there at high altitudes, and the temperature over there is also lower. So remember that lower the temperature, lower will be the rate of transpiration. So the plants which are present at those high altitudes, they have actually developed themselves, and nature has amazingly created them by creating these conditions which can actually help them effectively transpiring at a medium level. Next, we move on to soil water. You all know that water is going to be absorbed through soil only. So this soil water is an important factor which decides the rate of transpiration. So this availability of soil water is also determining the rate of transpiration. So by this, I think now this is very clear to all of you, the factors which affect transpiration. This was a brief overview of all these factors, internal factors and external factors. Internal factors, we have discussed leaf area, leaf structure, succulence, root shoot ratio, rolling, twisting and curling. And in case of external factors, we have discussed light, temperature, humidity, wind, atmospheric pressure and soil water. I hope this is very clear to you, and remember, when you're going to answer the questions in the examination about the factors which affect transpiration, please explain all these points in detail so that you the examiner has also fair understanding of how these concepts are clear to you. I hope that I have made this concept sufficiently clear to you all.